Well, Happy New Year, everyone. Today is January the 1st, 2014, and continuing on with the building of the little Stuart 10V engine. I do want to stop just a moment and just thank everyone for following along my channel. As I mentioned a couple of months ago, I was off for nearly a year, actually over a year, as we were involved in move and relocating here back to Texas. I do appreciate everyone's comments and for everyone who takes time to just send along a comment, suggestion, or perhaps an error that I made, whether it be in math or layout or just an alternate suggestion. I do read each one of your comments and I try my best to respond to everyone. I'm not going to get into the Google Plus and the YouTube, but there's plenty of that that goes out. However, I just want you to know that occasionally there are comments that are left that I cannot respond to. I'm not real sure why they show up, but they just don't have a reply. If I have not replied to you, it may be because that's what the issue is. And I do try to reply and make an earnest effort. I may not get to everyone the day that it's out there, but I will get to it usually by the weekend, depending on the job demands and so forth. So continuing on with the Stuart 10V engine, let's continue with the crankshaft. Moving on with the crank, as I had inadvertently said before, even though I knew better, this is a forged crank. It's not a cast crank. A cast crankshaft would not be appropriate. As you know, it would need to be forged. A cast crankshaft would be just entirely too weak. Even on a small engine like this, it really wouldn't be worth the trouble of machining a piece of cast that would have that many stresses in it. So in order to machine this, the first thing I'm going to do is be machining these two parts of the crankshaft, the crankshaft itself. And I'm going to be bringing that down to, we're going to bring that down to 5/16. And 5/16 is 3/1/25. Got to get my mind straight here. That's going to be my final diameter of this crankshaft. Now, if I put that in a three-jaw chuck and try to drill a center hole or drill center, even though this is a forged crankshaft, it does have some stresses built into it. Now, this is an exaggeration. I want you to know it's an exaggeration. It's not this way when you look at it. But the reality is that even as straight as that is, it does have a bend in it. And it is enough in there that if I were to put this in the three-jaw chuck, this side over through here would actually be turning in such an arc. So I still need to get as much center as I possibly can in that get as much center as I possibly can when I center drill the end of that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch to the four jaw chuck, and because I have four jaws, now I can move this any direction I want to. And I'm going to go over to the sander and just knock off a few of the high burrs there where some of the things are a little bit higher and try to get it around as possible. Just a very, very light sanding on a sanding disc. Then I'll put an indicator in it and I'll indicate as much as I can to get that in the center. I have about 315 thousandths to play with, so I want to make sure that I get as much meat as possible. And then I'll also do the same thing on this end here in the four-jaw chuck. I'll show you how that works when we get to the lathe. All right, what I've done is I've just gone into the four-jaw chuck and I've lined everything up. I just did a quick center. I'm not sure I got that on camera. I think I had my camera aimed at the wrong thing a while ago. If it's not on there, I apologize. I mean, you can only do these one time, and I sure thought I had it in the frame, but it didn't. Anyway, the only thing I did, I just set it up in the four-jaw chuck and I just took a skim of about 15 thousandths off each side. And what I tried to do is get the center as close as I could, or the center hole as close as I could, so that when I turn it, I'll be able to have the diameter that I need, or my finished diameter. I'm going to now go to the faceplate, and that's what I have here. I've got a dead center up on the headstock. I'll be bringing a live center down on this end. I have a lathe dog down here to run it. I'll put a bolt along one of these sides. I'll show you how that setup is in just a moment. Now, before we get started with the crankshaft and turning it on the faceplate, stop just a minute and talk about how to mount this thing.
and not do any damage to the crankshaft. There's going to be a lot of pressure against this crankshaft. Crankshaft, of course, is going to be like this, and you know, then you've got a place over, and it goes over, and so on and so forth, and then you've got the two ends on it. There's going to be pressure coming in from both of those ends with the lathe itself, and also there's going to be pressure pushing against it that way. So how do you minimize that pressure and protect your crankshaft and make sure it's running true? One of the things that I've always done, and I recommend that you do also, is when you get it, a crankshaft or making a crankshaft, that you try to brace it for as little a pressure as you possibly can. And one way to do that, and I have filed, I just got through filing out that crankshaft journal where it'll fit this bolt. And then what you do is put that bolt in and just tighten it up as hard as you can tighten it. Now, that's a grade 5 bolt and a grade 5 nut, and I'm going to tighten down on that. And that will help eliminate some of that stress as it pushes in from both directions. Now, a crankshaft is one of those things, it has to turn true. If it doesn't turn true, your engine will bind. And I have found from experience that one of the things that causes that thing to bind is a crankshaft that was not turned true. So I'm going to go over there as soon as I get through off tape. I'm going to tighten that down really, really tight. Now let's talk about faceplate turning. Faceplate turning is really easy to do. In fact, faceplate turning was one of the oldest lathe turning jobs that was ever done on a screw cutting lathe. You'll see how the faceplate is set up over there on the lathe in just a few moments. Now, as you recall, I've already got that round. It's not to any specific dimension. I've just made sure that the journals are round. Now, I'm going to, from this point forward, I'm going to be making sure that both sides are turned identical diameters and that both sides are in exactly the same plane. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to turn one side, then I'm going to reverse it and turn the other side. And I'll do that with faceplate turning. And I'll do both of them between centers. There'll be a center on this end and a center on that end. To drive it, because I'm not going to be driving it in a chuck, I'm going to be using a faceplate and a lathe dog. Now this is a homemade lathe dog. It's just pieces of half inch keystock. Actually, that looks like probably around 7/16 by half, but it doesn't matter as long as it doesn't even have to be square. It's just so that you can get some bolt holes in it to tighten it up. I made this one years ago, and I use it for a lot around turning these crankshafts. They're really easy to build. Just take your keystock, drill a couple of through holes in it. I use quarter inch hex bolts. So this piece right here has got the through hole. This piece here is threaded. And then I've got a couple of V's in there to hold it. So all I have to do is just come down and then tighten it up. And I tighten it up equally on both of them. And it doesn't take a lot to hold it. You're not bearing down a whole lot. You're just making sure that there's enough force to turn the crankshaft. And that you'll see how it goes in the on the faceplate in just a moment. On the finish side, what I'll do is I'll just come back and put a little masking tape on that side, and that'll prevent that from digging in. This is not hardened steel. This right here is just plain soft cold rolled steel is what I made that out of. Not even real sure I might have even used a keystock. Regardless though, that soft steel, it's not bad about marring anything. So off to the faceplate and lathe we go.
Okay, back at the lathe here, and I'm going to show you the tool that I'm using. I'm actually using a very rounded tool here. This is a high-speed tool steel, and it's just ground to a round on it, and that's what I'm using to bring the crankshaft down to the final dimension. See, right now I need to bring it down to 9/32, or 9/32 is 281 thousandths. And right now I have it at 286 thousandths is what we are right now. So I got to bring 4 thousandths more off. And I may do that. I'm going to take about another couple of thousandths, and I'm going to bring it on down to size with emery cloth, so I'll get a nice polish on that. Now, I've not done this side of the crankshaft yet. I've just done that side. So I'm going to bring it down to 2 thousandths, which is bring it around Oh, around 282, 83, and I'll take that last thousandth off. I'll measure it though before I go that far. I'm feeding by hand at a real slow rate forward.
Okay, I put the final pass on it.
And what I decided to do is use a little bit of this 320 emery cloth to polish it up. And since that's 281 thousandths is what I'm going to ream, I'm going to bring this down to 280 thousandths. That'll give me a 1/1000th clearing clearance to run. So that came in to be 281 thousandths. So that looks real good. Now flip it over, do the other side. By the way, I had several people comment and say, well, why didn't you just go ahead and use the four-jaw chuck? You could do that to turn these two sides right here without an issue. Wouldn't be a problem at all. But watch what I'm about to do here with, as soon as I get
the reason
that
I use the lathe dog is when I get ready to turn this thing over.
Well, let me find the right key. I thought I had it right up here. There it goes right there. 3/16 for a quarter inch. I should know that. All I need to do now is just take the lathe dog loose. And this is soft steel. And all I need to do is just bring this in over through here. That's got enough bearing. I know at one time I said that I would put masking tape on it. I really won't need to on this crankshaft right here. All I need to do is just turn this in and get it lined up straight, snug it up, and I'll do the final snug when I'm in the lathe. Remember, the only thing this has to be is just tight enough to make sure the crankshaft turns. Now, I've also tightened up the nut and the bolt. That'll help some of the tension, the pressure against it. On the lathe plate, now a face plate, all I need to do is get everything lined up again and put that back in. And now since I'm turning on a face plate, everything is going to be exactly in line. I'm actually turning between centers. The centers have never moved. You'll also notice that I've also got a counterweight over here. That's so that I can do this without the lathe being out of balance. Put just a little bit of oil on the dead center. I'm using a dead center here, not a live center. And the reason I'm doing that is I just don't have enough room up here for a live center and the lathe bit to go in there at the same time. So now I'll just start back and finish up the other side of the crankshaft, bring it down to 281 thousandths also. I believe that'll work. Go ahead and do it one more time. Just do that. 280 thousandths. It's exactly the way we're looking for. So that's going to be a good, nice fit. 280 on each side. So we've got a good matched up piece. To go ahead and take that out. All I have to do now is just take it out of the center. And next thing is go ahead and put our fixture in, or the go put the fixture in that I made, and start turning the crankshaft journal itself. So unpop this, and there is the beginnings of a crankshaft. Nicely turned, nicely polished, nicely smooth. That's gonna do fine. Gonna do real fine right there. All right, join us on the next one.
Well, I'm sure by now many of you have already figured out the mistake that I made. It was a critical error. It's not an error that was not necessarily in vain, but I did mess up pretty critically on this crankshaft. Ended up with a perfectly machined crankshaft, equal on both sides, great running finish that had been just fantastic to go ahead and put into the machine. Unfortunately, I did it for 9/30 seconds. And 9/30 seconds is not the diameter that I wanted, because I don't have a reamer for 9/30 seconds. I wanted one for 312 thousandths would be, or 5/16 was what I initially wanted that to be, because I had the 5/16 reamer. So I'm going to save that crankshaft for another project, and what I will do is go ahead and fabricate a crankshaft with 5/16. Not really a great loss. You can go ahead and use those same machining techniques for a crankshaft if you choose to, or you can follow along, and I'll show you in the next series as I start to build the fabricated crankshaft. In many ways, a fabricated crankshaft is a little easier to build, but I was wanting to use this one simply because it came in the kit that Galen had sent along. I did not realize it until I actually put the crankshaft in the fixture that I had. Here's where I messed up. It's always important to make sure that you have your blueprint in front of you. I did not have the blueprint in front of me, and that's where I went astray. I was trying to rely on memory. Never do that. What happened in the new shop, I did not have this screwed. I actually take this and screw it to the back of the lathe shelf that I'm working with, so I can keep this in mind. I was trying to rely on memory. Don't do that. Well, so long in this video. Kind of a convoluted setup that I did, and really messed up on that one. So join us on the next time as I start the fabricated crankshaft. Maybe a week or two before I get it out, I'll need to order some drill rod to get this started. See you on the next video.